Welcome, friends, to this third and final day of our three-day program in London. Once again, I'm very happy to see all of you and to share with you some of the experiences I have had with my master, the great master, Rul Maharaj Baba Sawan Singh, who initiated me on the 9th of March, 1936. That is, the anniversary will be tomorrow for that. So tomorrow is an important day for me, a life-changing day. I think there is nothing that changes our life more than initiation by a perfect living master. Initiation by a perfect living master is not merely teaching us how to meditate. It is a master taking responsibility for our soul and guaranteeing that our soul will be taken to Sachkhand, to our true home. There is no guarantee I am aware of more valuable than this guarantee, because we have been roaming around in this cycle of reincarnation, cycle of death and birth, birth and death. We have been roaming around for so long that to be able to get a way out from here, from this mess, and to ultimately reach our true home, to where we belong to, so it's a great thing, the greatest thing. So that is why every year on the 9th of March, I think it's a very special day for me. And I remember how I was young. I was less than 10 years old, 9 and a half. My grandfather asked me, while I was playing in the field, we were playing a game called Gulli Danda. In Punjab, you know how we play. And full of dirt and dust. And great master was sitting giving initiations. And my grandfather came and he said, come, I'll get you half initiation. In those days, great master used to give half initiation to young children. If they were really young, not teenagers yet, he would give them the dhun, or the practice of listening to the sound first. He would just say, close your ears and you can hear sound. And once they grew up to be teenagers, we would go back for the second half of our initiation, and then he would give us simran, how to repeat words. So my grandfather told me, I'll take you for half initiation. I was surprised that he took me there, but he took me in front of great master, who was sitting in a chair, and chanti was going on, selection was going on, and people were being brought in front of him, and he was asking them, do you drink, stop alcohol, don't meat, are you vegetarian, questions like that. And then he would either say, you are ready and go for initiation inside the room, or wait for another time. So this chanti was going on, this lecture was going on. Then my grandfather presented me to the great master. He caught hold of my arm and said, what do you want? I said, I want naam, initiation. He said, what kind of initiation, sweet or salted? I had heard him say that to the other children also. And most children said sweet. So he would take up a few patashas or some other sweets which were close by in a bag and give them, and they would run away. So I knew he's playing the same trick with me. So since I had heard this before, I said, no, I don't want sweet or salted. I want that is inside here. So he laughed and said nothing. So I thought the game is over. He said nothing. That means it's just a sweet or salt thing. But he did not let go of my arm. So I was saying, now that it is gone, I'm not being initiated, even half initiation, he should let go of my arm so I can go run and play my Gulli Danda again. But he did not let go of my arm. All the chanti was completed. And he, still holding my arm, got up and said, come inside and you will get full initiation. It's a surprise for me. And certainly it was a much bigger surprise for my father And for my grandfather, when I came home after initiation, I said, he gave me full initiation. He told me, sit down in front of him. And I sat right in front. And I remember his words so clearly today, as if he spoke this morning. He said, what I am giving to you, he was telling everybody who was being initiated, what I am giving to you, I got from my own guru, Baba Jamal Singh. It has worked for me, and I hope it will work for you. But if you find something better than this, you take it. Don't come back to me for my permission. I am giving you permission in advance. If you find something better, take it. Do me one favor, that when you get something better, come and tell me, so I will also go and take that. These are words of great master. What has impacted me so much about these words is that he was so open. He did not say, I'm binding you down to something. It was clear it was not a cult he was talking about, where you bind down and say, you can't go anywhere. Now you have to remain loyal to me. You have remained faithful to me. He didn't say that. He left it open. Not only open, I almost got the feeling he has told me, go ahead and find something better. I accepted the challenge. I said, I will find something better. One day, maybe I'll find something better. I'll go and tell him. So that is why I, after that, searched for something better. But what was happening? He was so clever, he arranged something to happen shortly after my initiation, which made it even more necessary for me to look for something better. And that is when I came home and told my father, who was already initiated by him, that I got full naam, full initiation from great master. He was very happy. And some satsangis, elder satsangis, came to our house, and my father pronounced very proudly, my son Ishwar got full initiation at this age, 9 and a half. And they said, oh, we are very sorry to hear that. Satsangi told them, we are very sorry to hear that. This is what happens when you get a young child initiated. He will grow up and find this was just an imposition on him. He will find he was forced into it, and he will rebel, revolt against it, and he will never follow this path again. This was a big mistake to get him initiated. That's what they said. I was not in the room when this conversation took place. I was in the neighboring room, but I heard the whole thing. I was eavesdropping what they were talking. And I realized, maybe they are right. They gave an example. They said, look at Bhagat Singh, such a devoted disciple of great master, his attorney. And Bhagat Singh's son, Nikki, Gurdyal Singh, whom we called Nikki. Nikki was initiated when he was 11 years old. And when he grew up, he said he was just forced into it and never followed the path again. They gave an example also. That here's an example. It's very wrong to get a young child initiated like this. So I heard all this conversation. I said, maybe they are right. That I have got into this just because my father was Satsangi. Supposing my father was a Christian going to a Catholic church, I would be following that church. And I believe that is the only true way to find God. If I was a Muslim, I would be going to the mosque and would be worshipping and reading the Quran. It just happened by accident that I am born to a father who is following this master and I am following him. I never got a chance to examine what I am getting. Never got a chance to verify if it is valuable or not. Maybe what great master said was right. That I should not just accept what he is giving at its face value. I must go and search. So right from that early age, I began to go around searching. I could not accept these teachings just as they were. And another thing happened, even worse than that. When I was very little, about 4 years old, I could hear a lot of sounds. And they were frightening sounds, because I could not know where they are coming from. I used to stand near a window and look out, is there sound coming from this side? Then the sound appeared to be from the other side. I'd go to the other window of the room and sound seemed to come from the other side. I was frightened where, and when I told my parents and other people in the house, they said, we can't hear it, so you are crazy. So it made me even feel worse. As soon as I got initiated, the sound stopped. Other satsangis were telling me that when you get initiated, then you get sound, you get shabad. And here I had shabad with me and finished. What kind of initiation was that? Another reaction. So all these combined led me to search for the truth anywhere I could find. I went and got baptized into Christianity because I had gone to a Christian school earlier. So I said, that's maybe the way. I got dipped into the water. I went, converted to Islam. A friend of mine was a Muslim. I went to the mosque to worship with him, did namaz with him. I went to the yogis and practiced the Kundalini yoga, practiced hatha yoga, all kinds of yoga. Spent 8-9 years as I grew into my teenage years as practicing everything. Still trying the method of meditation that great master taught, but not accepting fully that maybe there is something better. After trying for so many years, a great master watching and laughing at me every time I saw him. He's laughing and I said, I'm trying to find something better. And he would laugh and say, yes, yes, go ahead. Never discouraged me. Never said, no, no, this is the true path. Don't go anywhere. Never said that. Which emboldened me to search more. So it's only after I found that none of those things that I was trying ever satisfied me. Not only did they not satisfy me in terms of any practice, they did not satisfy me intellectually to accept that that could be the path. There was some barrier there somewhere where they stopped and said, you can't go more than that. And that affected me. So after so many years, he came back. Then, of course, I said, I should try out fully this method and try it hard for meditation. No matter how many hours you have to do it, you must check it out fully. After all those efforts, and I grew up and I asked many questions from the master. He told me, you are a very intellectual person. You are always questioning everything. You are a skeptic. You have doubts. So you must ask all the questions. He never said, this is not a matter of questions, matter of faith, like some others had said. Other religions had told me, there's a matter of faith. You have to accept it. And therefore, you have to just follow on blind faith. But here this master was telling me, no, you must ask all the questions. He said, even if one question is lurking in your mind, it will not help you in your meditation. So you must get full satisfaction and get all your questions answered. The last question I ever asked him was in 1942. I still remember. After that, I didn't need to have any question till today. So he satisfied me fully. So far as the intellectual side, understanding the question. And that was the last question was also about an inner experience I had. So there was no question after that. And since I had spent so many years in asking questions, then I could answer other people's questions also. So things changed so rapidly. I examined this path. I went through it carefully. I traveled around the world. Opportunities came in my life to study abroad and thereby to travel to many countries. And I met many people. I met the Buddhist belonging to the Mahayana group. I met Buddhists belonging to the Hinayana group. I met Buddhists who were practicing the Zen method. All kinds of things I was able to see around the world. And after seeing all those things, I came to the conclusion that at least in this age, there is nothing more useful, more practical, more capable of being put into practice than the Surat Shabd Yoga taught to me by this man. So I am mentioning this historical fact about me. It's not that I've suddenly found out that he gave this teaching and I just accepted it. I compared notes. And I encourage everybody, you should compare what you have, compare what you're getting, and see if you're getting a good deal. This promises a good deal. One day in a satsang, he was giving a satsang and a phrase came in that shabad which was being read. Kaya nagar, nagar hai niko, which is sauda har ras kijiye. That this body of ours is like a township. In the township, there's a marketplace. You want to do a real sauda, real bargain of Hari's nectar, go there. I went to this great master of mine. I said, I heard this shabad today. Can I have a deal with you, a little sauda with you? He said, sure, what do you want? I said, a transaction or a sauda means I give you something, you give me something. He said, certainly, that's what a sauda is. I said, what about if I gave you all my worries, all my anxieties, all my suffering in the future, and you give me all the happiness and all the bliss? I put this proposal to him. He said, agreed. From that day till today, he has kept his word, I have kept mine. That such a deal was possible? Who could imagine? And the difficulty is, that deal is open to all of us. The difficulty is not that the master will not keep his deal. Difficulty is, we won't keep our deal. We worry unnecessarily, even we want to give up worry. So we worry, and even if we are told, it requires such deep faith to be able to say, I have given my worries to you, Master, you take care of everything. But if you can do it, the deal is available. I can tell you the greatest thing one can have from a perfect living master, that you can have such a deal. I came to the United States to study and met many old satsangis there. They invited me to talk in satsang, and I happened to mention this deal, and they criticized me very badly. They said, how unfair of you. You tried to cheat. You put all your problems and your worries at the doorstep of your master and tried to get all the bliss out of him. How could you burden your master like this? What an unfair thing you did. They criticized me very badly. I kept quiet. I said, these people have no idea what a master is. They have no idea what a perfect living master is. They have no idea who's sitting in that body of a master. The master who's sitting there, if they could realize who's in that body, that master by one touch of his finger can take the whole humanity back to Sachkhand. That's the power of the master. What are they talking about? As if he's an ordinary human being and I put my burden on him, he can take the burden of the entire universe. And nobody could imagine that. These are things they couldn't understand. And how could they understand? Unless you go within, unless you go and see the real form of the master, unless you know who is there that you're talking to, you never know. He is Satpurush in human form, right sitting here. His awareness is of Satpurush when he's a human being sitting with us. Nobody can see that. We think he's just an advanced human being. That he's somebody who has just accomplished something. That's not it. He's the very object of what we want to reach. He's the destination for us. That is why sometimes I wonder, when people are sitting in front of the perfect living master, they close their eyes to meditate. I said, what are you meditating for? The one you're meditating for is right in front of you. He's sitting right here, but you can't see him because he's covered himself. He's putting a costume that you can't see through it. The power of a perfect living master cannot be estimated by us. It is only when we make progress and we go within, we realize who he was. As we make more progress, we see more and more of the reality of our perfect living master. That is why we are talking of this small burden of telling us just to take the worries of one lifetime. That's nothing for a master. He can take all our worries. But we should be able to give the worries to him. The trouble is, it requires faith. It requires deep faith. It requires unshakable faith. Because if things don't go our mind's way, we lose faith. I have seen people who had inner experiences, who said, we have unshakable faith in our master. Everything is going according to our way. And then one bad thing happens in their life. The 99 things that were good are forgotten. And faith is lost. So what kind of faith is that? Therefore, to be able to give your worries, to be able to give all your anxieties, to be able to hand over the affairs of your life here and inside to the master, which is possible, requires that kind of faith. But the faith does not come without some progress in faith. There are two kinds of faith. A blind faith and a living faith, a growing faith. Blind faith is static. Somebody says, there is God sitting in heaven and you will go there, is blind faith. A statement has been made, you are accepting it. And all your life you accept it. Nothing happens. Faith is there. It's blind faith. Then there is faith that there is a master who can do this for you. Next morning a coincidence happens. How could this happen? And your faith grows a little. Then more happens. Faith grows more. It becomes a living faith, like it's growing like living things. That's quite different from blind faith. So when you have the faith developing with a master, it is a living faith because it grows with all your daily experiences. It grows with your inner experiences. It grows with your outer experiences. And when it grows to a level which is unshakable, it never shakes again. But do you know when that happens? The unshakable faith comes when you transcend your mind. So long as with your mind, even if the best things have happened in your life, the mind can topple you over and topple your faith. So the mind is the one that carries on with us, is helpful, so long as it is fed what it desires. And when it is not given what it desires, faith is lost. How could master do this to me? How could my child die? How could my so-and-so friend die? How could I be ditched by so-and-so? How could I lose all my money suddenly? How could I have this misfortune? Master's no good. He didn't take care of me. Faith has gone. But unshakable faith makes us feel that our karmic life, our pattern of life, is all going upside down according to our requirement, according to what we need, according to the capacity to learn from it, capacity to progress from it, and to live within this cheerfully, that no matter whether it's high or low, we cheerfully accept it. That power of acceptance comes through faith. Otherwise, you can't accept it. You only accept what our mind wants. So that is why I am telling you the great potential of knowing a perfect living master and being initiated by a perfect living master. It's a totally life-turning event. It changes everything. It changes your whole life. And if you take advantage of it, yes, you will get everything that you want. The soul seeking is satisfied only when you experience the unconditional love of a perfect living master. That love is so pure. It hits you directly in the soul. It has nothing to do with your body, senses and mind. It has nothing to do with your thinking. It hits your soul because something pulls you. You don't even know. The mind can't even understand. The mind doubts even that. But the pull of that love takes you beyond the mind, takes you even beyond your doubts and overrides your doubts. And that is what happens when you meet a human being who has got that kind of awareness. This is, people ask me, how do we know who is a perfect master? Who should we go to? Because a lot of masters, great master used to say, today there are more masters in the world than disciples. The number of masters grown so much. It's one of the finest businesses one can do. It's a very profitable business. And therefore, masters are growing in number all over. So when you say you want to follow a master, perfect living master, there's so many standing there. How will you know? And you can't recognize them because they are ordinary, simple people living like us. They don't show, they don't even say they are masters. They don't live like masters. They live like ordinary people. So how can you possibly know who's a master? When people ask me, what can I say? There's a list of signs of a perfect living master. But that list is not fully capable of telling you who is a master. The list says, a master will live like ordinary person. He will not claim to be a master. He will live with his own earning and will not live in the donations of his people. He will use the donations for the service of the people. He will not perform any public miracles. And so on. There's a list showing the outside form. But even an imposter can do these things. A fake master can also follow because fake master read this list. They say, we know what they want to look in a master, so here they are. So they can do all these things. And therefore, so many masters are there fulfilling these conditions. Then how do you find out? Then ultimately, the answer I give is your soul, the inner self of yours, being pulled by a master? Are you being pulled by the love in such a way that never experienced before? Are you being pulled beyond your mind's thinking? If that is happening to you, follow that master. No matter if he's perfect living master or not, follow that master. Because he's pulling you in the right direction. Secondly, if he says go within to find the truth, follow him. Supposing the master is fake, but he says go within, at least he's telling you the right way. He's putting you in the right track. He's not saying follow me or follow some temple or follow some ashram or follow some river or follow some ocean. He's telling the right way. So at least follow till you find out that he can't take you anymore. Some masters have reached certain levels of awareness. They've gone higher. So many have gone up to the astral plane where they see heavens and bliss of heaven. And they call it Satchkhand. And they believe it's Satchkhand. They're sincere masters. But they haven't gone higher than that. They don't know more. They have not had a chance themselves to find a perfect living master. So they think that is it. If you find such a master, go with it. At least he'll take you one major step forward. There's no how. Don't dilly-dally. I want to meet a perfect living master. I can't know where it is. And therefore I'm spending the whole life in searching for one and you die. It's better to find somebody who will take you at least part of the way. There are masters going to different levels of awareness. Perfect living masters are very rare. Masters will take you as far as they can go. They cannot take you higher than that. But if your seeking is for something higher, you will automatically, after that, find a master who will take you beyond. Automatically. It all depends on your seeking, what you are seeking. If you are seeking to go to your true home beyond your mind, beyond your thinking, you will find a perfect living master. He will find you. You don't have to find him. And if you have gone through a number of masters, it doesn't matter. Ultimately, you fix your destination at the highest point, you will go there. If you seek to go to Satchkhand, you will go to Satchkhand. I can tell you this. It's your seeking that takes you there. Masters are a means. They're just means to take you on the track. And supposing a young child says, my cousin goes to college and the teacher is a PhD and my school teacher is not PhD. He's done only a BA. I don't want to go to my teacher. I want to go to the PhD. We tell him, but right now you've gone nowhere. You have to go to school and go to a teacher who teaches up to that point. When you've grown up to that point, crossed your school teaching, then you go to college, then you get that PhD professor to teach you. It's not dissimilar in spirituality. In spirituality, we are sometimes just beginners and anybody can help us. See, eventually, when you meet the perfect living master, he does not say, oh, you spent all your time wasting your time with these masters. No, he never will say that. He'll say, you come to me at the right time. There's a true story I've shared with some of you, and I'll tell you now about an engineer in Burma, Trilokchan, and he was working in the public works department, engineer in Burma, but a very great seeker of the ultimate truth. He learned that in Madras, which is now called Chennai in India, in that town there is a Swami, and he can enlighten you and give you information and take you to Sachkhand. That's what he wanted. Now, he was a man who was very cautious with his money. When I say cautious with money, do you know what that means? It means he would hold a 1 rupee note in his hand and say, to spend or not to spend, to spend or not to spend, not to spend, put it back in pocket. Thereby, he had accumulated 30,000 rupees. Although from a limited salary of an engineer, to save 30,000 in those days was a big thing. But he finished his job, cancelled everything, took the money and came to Madras to meet the Swamiji who could give him enlightenment. So he told the Swami, I have come for true enlightenment. I believe you can give it. Swami said, yes, I can. But there is a price to pay for it. Then the Swami mentioned the old story of King Janak, how he got enlightened. He said, have you heard the story of King Janak? He said, yes, Master, I heard, but you can tell me again. So he told him that King Janak was a seeker and he wanted to get real knowledge. He called his advisors, his ministers, can you find out people who can give me some real knowledge? They said, King Janak, you are in a very wonderful country, India. India is full of sadhus, yogis, yogeshwars, mahatmas. There are so many enlightened people here. All you have to do is to have a feast, a yag, and they will all come. So long as the food is good, we'll get more people in. So big langar was held and all the kinds of food was prepared. And all day the people came in and the king disguised himself like an ordinary person and he walked amongst them to see how much knowledge he can get from them, true knowledge. He was so shocked that these learned people were so angry with each other. They were almost fighting with each other. No, this is not what the scripture means. With the same book, they were giving interpretations, different interpretations and fighting with each other. He said, these may be learned people. They remember the scriptures by heart. They can repeat everything. They have no knowledge. I don't want learning. I want knowledge. They are learned people. So disappointed, he came back to the palace and told his advisors, I didn't want to have this kind of interaction with these different holy people that you gathered there. I wanted true knowledge. And they said, King Janak, you did not call all the people. This was just a local gathering. You should, by beat of drum, announce the whole country that you will have a yag and have it for 7 days, that everybody will come. So the king arranged a 7-day festival now and put up so many tents and camps, and all the yogis, yogeshwars, mahatmas of different people, some wearing white dress, some wearing yellow dress, some wearing orange colored dress, some wearing no dress, they all came and gathered there. Some were just smeared with ash. So a good gathering came up. And for 7 days, the king moved amongst them and he discovered it's a repetition of that 1-day event. They all were learned people. They recited from scriptures. They were very good at recitation. They chanted, but they had no knowledge. And none of them had real knowledge. He felt very disappointed. And he came back and told his advisors that, I am sorry, this is not what I wanted. I want real knowledge. I want real, absolute knowledge of the truth. What is happening? Real truth, not this kind of thing. They said, King Janak, if you want that, you have to go to somebody else, a perfect living master. And there is one who lives on the bank of the river. and his name is Ashtabakar. Ashta means eight, Bakar means the folds on his skin. He's little hunchbacked. He has eight folds on his skin. His body is little deformed, but the eyes are very sharp. And he is a real perfect master. And he doesn't come to these kind of festivals, the yugs that you hold. And King Janak said, why didn't you tell me first? I'll go to him and invite him to come and give me true knowledge. So he went there along with his retinue and asked him, beast on Ashtabakar, please come to my palace and give us true knowledge. Ashtabakar said, King, if you have come all the way to invite me, I will certainly come. And he fixed a date and time to come to give true knowledge to King Janak. When he arrived at the palace, King Janak had in the auditorium of the palace organized a big meeting. All his relatives, neighboring princes and princesses, they all were assembled. So it was a very big gathering of noble people. So Ashtabakar came with seven or eight of his followers. They took off their shoes near the door. That was the custom. And Ashtabakar walks up. And all these people look at him, a hunchback man, coming to give them true knowledge. And they began to laugh and murmur and giggle at them. What had the king done to call us all for a meeting with this kind of a man? So Ashtabakar heard that. He came on the stage and he sat down on the chair next to the king's chair. Both of them sat on the stage. And Ashtabakar said, King Janak, what is the price of leather today? And King Janak says, Master, I don't understand. We invited you to give us true knowledge. What has leather to do with it? He said, are these not all leather merchants sitting here? Said, no. These are nobles and they are princes and princesses from different states. And they are not leather merchants. He said, the way they looked at my skin and my body, I thought maybe they are leather merchants. Then the people said, this guy has some sense of humor. So they stopped to listen to him. And Ashtabakar said, King, what kind of knowledge do you want? He said, I want real knowledge and I want instant knowledge. As a footnote, I should tell you, when I read this, I feel that King Janak must have been an American in a past life. They want instant everything. He said, instant knowledge. Ashtabakar said, King, you have to pay a price for that. He said, any price. All my coffers are open. All my wealth is open. You ask any price, it will be given to you for giving me true instant knowledge. He said, what is an instant? And King Janak said, instant is a short period of time. When I go horse riding, from the time I put my foot into the stirrup and jump on the saddle, that's an instant. He said, with that kind of knowledge, you have to give me three things. He said, Master, you can take 10. No, I only want three things. Give me your body, give me your wealth, and give me your mind. When you're given these three, I'll give you instant knowledge. It was a strange price tag, of course, but the king said, it's worth it. He said, Master, my body is yours. My entire wealth is yours. And my mind is also yours. Give me instant knowledge. The master said, Ashtabakar said, are you sure you have given your body, wealth and mind to me? Yes, Master. Okay, if this body is mine, I can keep it wherever I like. Yes, Master. Will you get up and take this body that belongs to me and go and sit on the shoes I left at the door where I came in? The king got up and said, I have to now obey wherever he wants to keep the body. Now when he's walking toward the shoes, the people again start murmuring, what kind of knowledge is this? They get a deformed hunchback guy and he says, go and sit on the shoes. Is they going to give him knowledge? And as they're murmuring and the king is passing by, he says, these people don't know. They only know about my palaces, that I am a wealthy king and I am this. That's what they are thinking, that why I am doing this. When he was thinking like that, Ashtabakar shouted from the stage, King, you have no business to think of your palaces and your wealth. You've given it to me. He said, oh my God, I forgot. King says, I had given it to him. Then he says, oh God, I have forgotten, I have given it to him. Ashtabakar shouts, you can't even think whether you've given it to me, you've given your mind to me. You can't even think. And he put his hand like this, can't even think. At that instant, he got enlightened. And Ashtabakar said, come back, you don't have to sit on the shoes. Come back and sit next to me. He came back, he said, did you get instant knowledge? Yes, Master. Was it at an instant, like you mentioned? He says, it was less than the instant. It was really instantaneous that I got that awareness. He said, look, King Janak, what I gave you is a sampling of what lies within us. Now, I will initiate you, and you meditate for 20 years, you'll get it again. Because this was a special grace that you got it from the Master. But live your life, be a king. And by the way, Ashtabakar says, I don't need your body. I have a problem with my own. I don't need your wealth. I'm very happy where I am. And certainly I don't need your mind. I have a problem with my own. So keep these. But from today onwards, think that this body belongs to Ashtabakar. Think that all your wealth belongs to Ashtabakar. Think your mind belongs to Ashtabakar, given to you for use. If you can keep this awareness that all these belong to the Master and given to you for use, you will make rapid progress on the spiritual path. Gave a good teaching to King Janak, and the Swami in Madras told the Lokchand, the engineer, this is the story of King Janak. I follow the same principle like King Janak. So you give me your body, give me your wealth, give me your mind, I'll give you true enlightenment. And the Lokchand said, yes, sir, I give you my body, I give you my wealth, and I give you my mind. Now give me true knowledge. He said, let's start with the wealth first. How much do you have? He said, I had collected 30,000 rupees. And he said, first transfer that to my account. I am planning to build a temple. So now imagine this man who was not willing to spend a single rupee. How strong his seeking must have been that he transferred the 30,000 rupees to the Swami. And then the Swami said, now we'll deal with the body. And to deal with the body, I will teach you a system of pranayama, a system of breathing, which is not like ordinary pranayama. It's a breathing which you have to do alternately with one nostril, then the other one. You take in and out with the right nostril, then take in and out with the left nostril, and you can't use your fingers. Because if you use your fingers, your attention will go out. Therefore, it has to be done internally. That means with your tongue twisted back, inner side of the nostrils, you have to move your tongue and close one and the other like this. And for that, you have to make a sacrifice. Because the tongue can't turn back. It's tied down with the tendons. And I have to cut those tendons. He says, my master made me do it. And he took out his tongue like a snake, it came out. The big tongue loose. And he could put the tongue back and perform that exercise. And he said, to make it a real sacrifice of your body, I will not do it by a surgical little cut on the tendons. I'll scrape them through sandpaper. And I'll also make it worse by using a nettle, bichubuti, to make it more painful. So that you know you made a sacrifice to get true enlightenment. And can you imagine, this man, the Lokchand, went through the torture for more than a month. Screaming every day, but wanting enlightenment. After a month, his tongue got loose. Then he practiced how to do it. Then he said, you give me your mind. He said, all right. Then he taught him a mantra to go with the breathing. And the Lokchand saw some lights. Sometimes he would feel very peaceful. Sometimes he would feel that he's exhausted. But he did not get what he wanted. Many years later, he was able to come to Great Master. And Great Master initiated him. And he made rapid progress because he had practiced a lot of concentration, of attention. As he made progress, one day, we were all sitting near Great Master in the evening, And we used to have informal gathering, about 10, 12 people sitting. I was there, he was there, some others were there. And this man says, Deen Dayal, merciful one, I did not know everything has to come from you here. Had I known before, I would not have given those 30,000 rupees to that Swami. He was still thinking of the 30,000. And great master answered and said, Trilok Chand, you don't know. The day you came to me, I transferred those 30,000 to my account. And then he explained, no effort with any master, with any Swami goes waste. No effort on the spiritual path ever goes waste. It all accumulates. And when the perfect living master meets you, whatever you have done, wherever you have done, is not wasted. There were steps that you took towards the final stage when the perfect living master could take you back home. So I'm telling you this story because too many people are worried. Oh, is my master real or non-master? Am I really initiated or not? They ask me these questions. I respect all masters who say, go within. I'm not guaranteeing how far they've gone. I'm no judge of that. I'm not supposed to be commenting upon their status or how much they've done. That's none of my business. It's not my business to be evaluating. I don't want to judge even people. How can I judge masters? Therefore, I tell them, it doesn't matter. So long as your seeking inside is there, and the love, unconditional love of a master pulls you. One gentleman sent an email to me. He said, I have seen your talk on YouTube in which you said that the way to pick up a master and accept a master is to see how you're pulled by a master. I am being pulled by two masters. Who should I follow? I said, well, whoever pulls you stronger with unconditional love and non-judgmental love, follow. He says, both pull me unconditionally. Both have equal love for me. What shall I do? I said, people have a hard time finding one. You found two. You're very lucky. Follow anyone. The point here is not, these are games we are playing outside in this physical world. We have become separated. It is a show of separation. Therefore, in this game, let's not get lost with the local moves of who is who and who is where. We are going into a place where we will find the unity of all souls, where we will find that the soul is not tied up with these bodies of ours. We are going to find a knowledge that is way beyond what is going on here. We are going to leave this behind. This is not our place. That is why these are not very important things. The important thing is to seek within. And when you get an opportunity to be guided on the pathway, which is within yourself, take it. If it doesn't take you beyond and you still want to go further, automatically you will find out that this is the limit where I could go. I want to go further. It happened with the Trilok Chand. It has happened with many people. They've gone through so many of these phases of their own spiritual journey. Nothing is wasted. All steps lead to the same thing ultimately. So I am mentioning this to you because it's a frequent question people ask me. They say, we are confused. We are confused who to follow. Then the other confusion is, we have committed ourselves to follow one master. We are not satisfied. Inner satisfaction has not come to us. But we feel if we now go to another master, even though we are being pulled by another master, is going to be, you know, being not faithful. We are being disloyal, unfaithful. They are almost treating like they are married to the first master, now they are being faithful, getting to another woman like that. Masters are not like that. It's not a marriage between husband and wife or something. It is a relationship of disciple and master. It's a relationship of following a teacher who teaches you up to a certain point. And you can't stay in a primary school and say, this master has taught me, now I won't go anywhere else. You have to move forward and go forward. So this whole concept, supposing you get stuck with this concept, that I am very faithful, I cannot go. Do you know what that means? That means it's not a teaching of spirituality, it's a cult that holds you down there. There's a difference between spirituality and a cult. A cult holds you down and says, you have to be faithful and loyal, you can't go anywhere. And spirituality says, go anywhere. Go and find the best. The message of these perfect living masters is for the whole of humanity and open completely. Go and find and search. We are giving you something. Find better, take it. We'll also take it. That kind of openness exists in the teachings of perfect living masters. They don't bind you down and close out. If anybody says, you can't go anywhere, now you come to me. If you go anywhere, you are being unfaithful. He's not a perfect living master. I can tell you right now. He's creating a cult, he's restricting you in your own seeking. How can there be a master who restricts you in your seeking? You still think he's a perfect living master? You should be open to seek and seek to the fullest extent. And when you reach a certain point, you want to seek more, somebody else teaches you more, go ahead and follow it. So I'm making these points today because so many emails come to me, so many people ask these very questions that are we doing the right thing? We are confused about this thing. So I said there should be no confusion about this. My own experience, I have met so many masters. I think I have met more masters than anybody, any one of you in my whole life. And I could see at what level they can take me. They could take me only up to certain levels to which they had gone. Firstly, no master can take you beyond where he's gone. Secondly, not even a perfect living master is a master for everyone. A perfect living master has come for his marked sheep. Another one may be there for you, but he'll help you to reach your master. So there is nothing to be worried about it, to be confused about it, and you should be able to follow this without problem. Yesterday, we did some meditation. I want to follow up on that. How many of you today want to do meditation again? Oh, I'm so happy. Quite a number today. All right. So don't make it so mysterious. One of my objects of telling you these things is to demystify all these ideas. Oh, there is some astral plane somewhere. It's nowhere, it's here. It is nowhere else except here. Everything is here. And somebody sent me a nice song, Multani kind of song, sung by a Pakistani girl, which said, "Ith nahi te kith nahi." If it is not here, it's nowhere. Everything that you have to find is here and nowhere else. There is nowhere else. Everything is here. Everything is right within you, right inside, right here where you are, right where your consciousness appears to be. That's where everything is. And you'll find it right there. So that is why I make it easy for you to not get into such a mysterious state. We don't know where astral plane is, where causal plane is. And sometimes we think they are one above the other. As if you have to fly sky higher up. It's not higher up, it's within you. You have to go more within, not go higher. But mind likes not only the terminology of higher, it also likes to classify it like higher. And we draw charts. Here's the physical plane, on top of it the astral plane, on top of it the causal plane. It's none of the business at all. It's not like that. You're not placed like this vertically up there. And some people look up and told some people are meditating with something up in the sky here. They look up in the sky outside the body. They won't find anything. It's all created from inside. The whole structure that we are observing outside is arising from inside. The truth is inside. We have to go within, more within, more within, more within consciousness. Not only within the body. More within what we experience as the body, more within the consciousness of that body. Then only we discover it's not something placed like this. But the mind likes this kind of classification. Much easier to understand for the mind. This is more difficult for the mind to understand how it can be more within. But the truth is very different. The truth is everything is to be found by removing the awareness of the covers upon you. That's all. It is not that you have to find yourself. It is to regain the awareness of yourself by removing covers and costume that you are covering yourself with. These are three big covers upon us. The very first cover, which is very heavy, is the cover of our mind. The soul is covered by the mind on all four sides. It's covered so well that the soul, which is the unit of power, that empowers and gives life to the mind, is hidden, and the mind becomes as if it is the only living thing. Can we ever sit and say that this is my mind and inside it is my soul? Have you ever thought like that? No. When I first came to the Western countries, to United States and Europe, people were telling me, you know, this business of spiritual practice and this so-called mind, soul, whatever it is, as if there's no difference between mind, soul. They're taking it as just the unit of thinking is the mind, soul. People also thought they think with their soul. They also thought that soul has to think and decide things. The soul never thinks. Why not? Because it can use the mind to think. It's been given a machine to think. It has been given an accessory to think. The mind has been given so we can think through the mind. Why do we have to think? We don't need to think. We don't need to reason. We don't need to use logic. We don't need to have any experiences of the mind, except that when we want experience, we use the mind. What do we want if we don't have a mind? We only want love and bliss, joy, appreciation of beauty, which is inherent in us. We don't need the mind for these things. For intuitive knowledge, knowledge without time, we don't need the mind. But for reasoned knowledge, for making sense and going through logic, yes, we need the mind. But we should separate the two things. We are the soul, not the mind. But the mind covers us so tightly that we can't even see the distinction between them. During my meditation retreats, when we do effective meditation for long periods, I do one exercise where you can watch your mind separately from yourself. And first discovery comes, the mind is a thinking machine, thinking in front of me, I can see it. And then the ability to separate yourself from the mind comes, and that's very useful when you want to go beyond the astral plane and understand what the causal plane is like. So these experiences will tell you that the whole thing is naturally built into us, and we are making too much of a mystery out of it, and we are making it more difficult for ourselves. If we keep the mind aside, things are simple. But the mind makes it more difficult. The mind tries to externalize everything. Mind tries to compare things with what we are observing as an outside experience. And it's not like that at all. So therefore, if you're wearing too many coats, you know, we sometimes overdress ourselves. I read a little email somebody sent me. It's a joke. They said that there was a blonde woman. They always make jokes of blonde women. The blonde woman married to a man, and she said, my man thinks I am dumb because I am blonde. I am going to prove to her that I am not blonde. I am not dumb. I am blonde, but I am not dumb. So when the husband went to work, she decided to paint the house so that he'll get very happy to see that I have done something worthwhile and not dumb. So she began to take the paint and began to work. Husband comes home and finds she is wearing a coat and an overcoat on top of it and lying in sweat. He said, what has happened? Are you all right? Yes, I was trying to show you that I am not dumb. I might be blonde, but I am painting the house. He said, why are you wearing these double coats on you? She said, I saw the instructions on the paint box. It said, for best results, use two coats. I'm only giving you example. I don't get all emails with spiritual questions. A lot of them carry jokes also. So I sometimes share with you these jokes because, after all, this is a heavy subject, and little lightheartedness is all right. I can tell you from my experience, this man, the great master, my master, was full of humor. He could crack many jokes, and practical jokes also. he created a certain atmosphere where we could laugh. And I knew that laughter was great. But when we get into heavy debate, our mind is trying to absorb things, we become very serious. So once in a time, I think once in a way, we should get off it. I mentioned to you his famous disciple, Dr. Ishwar C, who brought his father tied up on a cot and got him initiated. But the other story, which is more poignant from my point of view, more subtle, was that the great master was doing his satsangs, he was doing his discourses in the Dera only, and that was part-time when he would come. He was still working in the government. He took premature retirement at age 50. Then he settled down in the Dera. And the first time he made a tour outside of the Dera to give a discourse was again in Kapurthala on the invitation of this Dr. Ishwar C. But at that time there were two rich people living in that town. One was a professor, Professor Bhatnagar, who had a big house there. And the second was Diwan Daryailal, about whom I spoke yesterday. They had big houses. And when they heard that great master has accepted the invitation of this poor Dr. Ishwar C, who lived in a small little room, a little veda, a little courtyard outside, where even the cows will come and leave their pathis or something, not very clean place even, that Ishwar C has invited, they went and they said, you can use my car. Ishwar C said, yes, use your car to bring the great master and I will get the place cleaned. So he got all the sevadars, all satsangis, come clean up the place, first time master is coming out of the Dera, and he'll come to Kapurthala and visit my house. So Professor Bhatnagar and Daryailal took their one of the bigger cars and went to the Dera to bring the master. And great master came with them. Ishwar Singh is cleaning up the place. His wife Maya is helping. Many satsangis are helping him. And his house was in a small lane in the beginning of Kapurthala town. When the car came, all the satsangis were standing there outside with their hands folded, that now the car will turn into this lane and go to Ishwar Singh's house. The car never turned there because Professor and Diwan, they said, Master, Ishwar Singh has only a small little hut, a small little room in which he lives, and we have made arrangements in our houses. Whichever you like, you can stay there. So the car went straight, and the Sangat waiting for him near Ishwar Singh's house said, Ishwar Singh was mistaken that he'll come to his house. The master is gone. And they came and told Ishwar C, you know, he's not coming to your house, he's just gone to the house of those rich people. Ishwar C said, no, he can't do that. He is my yaar, he is my friend, more than my master. He will come to my house. They said, don't be a fool, he's already gone. And what was happening in the meantime? The car drove to Professor Bhatnagar's house and master got out and all family members, they bowed to him and they said, Master, we have a room reserved for you here and shall we take out your bags, your luggage? He said, no, leave the luggage in the car. So they thought maybe he'll go to the Daryailal's house now. So after some little chit chat with those people, he got back into the car. They drove to the Daryailal's house. There they said, Master, we have a room reserved for you here also. It's a little better situation here. We have big lawn for satsang and all the people are gathering. We have called them to have satsang here. You will give darshan and satsang. So Master got down and talked to them and he said, leave the luggage. He said, Master, these are the two best places. Where do you want to stay? And great master says, you know that poor Ishwar C? He's waiting for me. He said, Master, he doesn't have any place. It's only one small room. He said, but he lives there. I can also live there. But master, he has no bathroom. He says, then how does he use bathroom? He says, he takes a bucket on top of his roof and he just pours water on his head. And that's all he does. He says, for one day, I can also do that. Master, there's no arrangement there. We have all the arrangements here. He said, poor fellow is waiting there. Meantime, all the Saptangis ran away from Ishwar Singh's house. His wife Maya said, you have been a fool. You've always been a fool. You never realize the truth. They have all gone there. Everybody has gone to Satsang. And you think Master will come here? I am also going. She also left. He locked himself up in that room and cried. He said, Master, what kind of friend are you? You said you are my friend. This is how you treat friends. That you promised me that you'd come here and you go on to the rich people because the rich people have better houses and better accommodation for you. Meantime, Master's car is coming back. All the satsangis are away. Master takes and stops in that lane. He says, stop the car here. Don't take it near the house. He tells, there was Shadi, his guard, a driver. He says, stay in the car. I will go myself. And he gets down. This is first trip out of the Dera. Don't forget this. He walks and knocks at the door. Ishwar Singh is inside. He's thinking another Satsangis has come to call him. And he says, go away from here. Go away. I don't want to go anywhere. And Master knocks again and says, this is Sawan Singh. And he hears the Master's voice. He opens. Master walks in, hugs him. And both are crying. And he shuts the door. He said, Ishwar Singh, you thought I will not come here? No, when I make a promise, I come. He said, I will sleep in this room. I'll use the bucket that you use upstairs. And for 3 days, Satsang was held in Ishwar Singh's house right there. When you hear this story, you can feel how masters feel. You can feel how he felt. He felt so overjoyed that he is a friend, a true friend. He is not only a master. Before this guy, Ishwar Singh, died, he told me, Pachhanya nahi. We didn't recognize him. We didn't know what he was. He was more of a friend than he was a master. He was friend first and master afterwards. And I can tell you, my experience is identical with him. He's a friend first and master afterwards. It's not that he's a master, then become friendly. He's friends first and then we discover he's a master. We don't even know fully about him. So I'm sharing these stories to tell you the truth about perfect living masters. It's not what we think they are. So if we are so lucky to be able to be found by a perfect living master, there's no better luck than that. I'm so happy that I could share all this information. Some of it was very personal about my own journey. And some of it is stories about other people like the Lokchand and Ishwar Singh. But these are examples which give us a message, give us an information on where we stand ourselves. So I hope they will be useful to you, these inspiring stories of these great satsangis that I had chance to come across. We'll take a break now. I'll meet you again in the afternoon. Okay, thank you very much. We'll break it.